Good evening, everyone. I am very delighted to welcome you all to this talk on Nature versus Nurture, How the Environment Shapes Our Gene by Professor Sanjeev Galindé, who I really don't need to introduce to all of you, but I'll mention a few things about him. He obtained his PhD in biochemistry from Indian Institute of Science in 1996. Then he moved to USA for his postdoc at the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory. On his return to India, he joined NCCS as a senior scientist and worked there till 2010. Then he shifted to IISER Pune as a professor and established the Center of Excellence in Epigenetics. He was the former chair of biology and the dean of research and development at IISER. He was awarded the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize in the year 2010 and G.D. Birla Award in 2015. J.C. Bose Fellowship in 2019. Apart from it, he is an elected fellow of the two major Indian academies, Indian Academy of Sciences and Indian National Science Academy. He very recently joined as the Dean of the School of Natural Science at SNU and Institute of Eminence at Delhi. So he is an excellent researcher, an excellent teacher, and it was his tremendous support which helped IISER Pune IGM Team 2020 to achieve a gold medal. Almost everyone in IISER appreciate his teaching, and we are very honored to have him today for a talk. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you. I don't know your name, but thank you for the kind introduction. And also I thank the Science Club of IISER Pune for inviting me for this talk. I have actually given similar talks to a variety of age groups, from students of, I would say, high school to even people who are even retired people. So the entire age group, and also people ranging from those who are performing arts as well as those who are have nothing to do with sciences. Every time I've got some excellent feedback and questions from the audience. And today, this talk that I'm going to give is actually, of course, you have heard the title, but it's meant for students who are not very familiar with biology. Of course, those who have taken part of the epigenetics course that I used to teach at IISER Pune, some of this will be repeating information for them. But nevertheless, the examples that I give and some of the discussion will keep changing. So I hope I will keep it interesting for many of you. So what I'm going to do today is give some introduction to the topic and then go into discussing very, very useful examples that will actually, you'll be able to relate in terms of really how the environment, our immediate environment, somehow talks to our genes and manifests the entire genetic information in a completely different manner that is actually that could be unthinkable until now. And it's only because of some of the advances in modern sciences that have actually enabled us to even understand and be able to make some changes. So I'll talk about the therapeutics also towards the end of my talk. So the first picture that I'm always show in my classes also is this picture, which is still mind-boggling for me. This happens to be a single printed copy of our genome. So the Human Genome Project, which started in 90s and completed in its first phase by year 2001, and the first papers published till 2003, gave us the blueprint of the human genome, our genetic blueprint. And this information is seemingly quite simple, only four alphabets, A, C, T, and G, in random permutations and combinations. The word random is very important here because we believed this information to be random, and more so now it appears not to be very random. And again, I'll come back to this particular concept during my talk, because we tend to believe a large amount of things just based on limited knowledge that we have. And time and again, we disprove ourselves and rewrite textbooks. So especially in terms of genetics and epigenetics, this has happened very often, only in the last two decades. And that is possible because of the tremendous pace at which new technologies have been invented, and also various new analytical tools have been developed, mostly by contributions of people, not necessarily biologists. And I will also brush upon the contributions from chemistry, from physics, from mathematics, that have actually helped biologists to understand the basic principles of life and what makes us what we are. So what is the grammar of this language? That's the most important question, because this seems pretty simple. There are only four alphabets. Okay, so this is the picture I was talking about. This picture on the left-hand side that you see, the shelf of books that you see, these are the volumes, and this is a huge amount of information that every cell in our body carries. The numbers will quickly tell you that these are the chromosomes, 1 to 22, and X and Y, the sex chromosomes. The 23 pairs of chromosomes in our the nucleus of every cell in our body, except some cells like RBCs that do not have nuclei, but the other 50 to 60 billion cells that we have in our body actually have a humongous amount of information stored in them. Is it identical? Again, we believe that every cell in our body has identical information. That is also being questioned now with new data sets. People have actually looked at changes that happened during our lifetime for genome. So these are very interesting new things that are coming out every day. Science is bringing out new aspects of life. And it's mind-boggling. So if you look at any gene, so the sequence that I've chosen here is of one of the smallest genes. Still, it looks pretty dense here. And of course, you might not be even to able to read this sequence. But nevertheless, it's clear that just by looking at this, the grammar of this language, the genetic language, is not very clear. And in the early days of molecular biology, from the 80s to 90s, scores of labs, actually, those who actually pioneered molecular biology, went base by base to understand the genetic grammar. And now we, of course, understand most of it. I would not say all of it, because again, every day some new grammar is being discovered. But nevertheless, now we know. And if you now see what this particular gene HOXA1A actually encodes, is this. Okay, so this is now color coded, and you can see that there are bases in different colors. So obviously the ones in red, ATG on top is the start codon, and then TGA is the stop codon. But then there are multiple other colors you see here. Each of them means something different to this particular gene. So after knowing this limited amount of genetic grammar, which is basically the codon knowledge and the knowledge of the split genes, the introns, the exons, and many other sequences like the upstream regions, untranslated regions, the UTRs on the upstream side and the downstream side of the gene, what we call as the 5' and the 3' side of the gene. All of this information, is it really sufficient? Do we really think that this is, let's say, if this is the sequence of the gene, does it portray a complete picture or not? So that's the real question that we would like to address. And I'm going to give you examples which basically will portray that what you see here is a so-called gene has only the limited information, because it has the coding information for a protein, which is also by the same name of the gene. But how, when, and where this protein will be expressed. So these three words are very important, because, okay, you have a gene and there are multiple genes encoded in every genome. But the next important questions are how much in terms of the expression of the gene, where in terms of the spatial location, which part of the body, which cell type, and when. So that's the temporal part of it, okay? During what time of life, what time of the cell cycle, various time-specific kinetics, that becomes very important. So again, remember these three words: how, when, and where. These are very important when it comes to expression of genes. There's one thing to have them, okay? We all come with that genetic baggage, but then we are all very different from each other, not just in terms of the way we look, but also the way we behave, Okay, that's why we have different personalities. There is a genetic basis for all of this, and not just genetic basis, also epigenetic basis. Again, I'm going to emphasize this point again and again, because it's very important when it comes to the examples, especially with respect to the health aspects. So let's talk about the genomic context. Okay, so if you look at, as I said, the science of genomics has evolved dramatically in the last two decades, especially after the sequencing techniques have evolved. And what you see here is a graph that shows the comparison of genome sizes of various species across the phyla. And what you can see here, of course, this is the log scale, as you can see on the x-axis. And starting from top, archaea, to bacteria, to protists and fungi, and all other different clades and phyla, if you see, during evolution, there seems to be a trend that the genome sizes have slightly increased. Like, for example, if you compare archaea versus mammals, which is where we belong, there is a dramatic increase, orders of magnitude increase in the size of the genomes. But that's not necessarily true. There are large numbers of deviations to this. Some of the phyla, actually, you see species having a very broad range of genome sizes. And if you look at some of the plants, it could be like onion, or some of the protozoans like amoeba, they have genomes which are orders of magnitude bigger, larger than the human genome. Okay, our genomes are here, marked here in this black line at the bottom in mammals, 3.3 gigabase. But there are a large number of species, like as you can see on this graph, and mind you, this is a log scale. So you can imagine the orders of magnitude increase genomes of species which seemingly are not as complex as the humans. Okay, so then is it the size of the genome that makes us so complex? That was the myth that was busted in 2003 when the Human Genome Project decoded the sequence. Many people thought that humans will have far more number of genes. The large number of biotech companies that sprung up in Western countries, thinking that they will patent all those critical genes that are unique to humans, and therefore will make a lot of money on that. But then, of course, most of them went bankrupt after the meaning of this entire genome was decoded. And it turned out that we actually do not have far too many genes over other species, which are evolutionarily quite distant to us. Fruit flies, okay, do not have much less number of genes than compared to humans. Mouse, another mammal, but in terms of many behavioral aspects and other aspects, we believe that humans are far more complex than many other mammals. But then the number of genes are not drastically different between these species. So the answer to the question that does it really matter how many genes do we have? So this becomes almost meaningless, is because the coding capacity of the genome is not necessarily relying on the number of base pairs in a genome. So that is the size of the genome. Because each gene, so you know the split gene hypothesis, each gene can give rise to several proteins because of alternative splicing. Each protein can be then covalently modified, chemically modified in multiple ways. And this is very important for epigenetics, because that's exactly what brings out different meaning to each gene and its expression pattern in multiple ways. And then the third aspect is that these proteins, which are decorated by different modifications, then further make different types of complexes. Just take three proteins, A, B, C. A can partner with B, A can partner with C, B can partner with C, C can partner with B and A. So you can imagine the number of permutations and combinations. So if you have thousands of proteins, you can imagine the number of different machineries that you can create just by putting different part of the puzzles together, okay? So that's a humongous possibility. So the number of permutations, combinations that you can imagine by these three mechanisms is actually astronomical. The number is really astronomical. So you have split genes that can give rise to several proteins. They are modified in multiple ways, and they can also form different types of complexes. And that's exactly what keeps on happening inside the body. So with limited coding capacity, human genome and many other genomes code for not more than 20,000 plus minus few thousand genes, plus minus maybe 2,000. So you can imagine within 15,000 to 25,000 genes, okay, you can cover all the forms of life. Okay, I'm talking about multicellular organisms. I'm not talking about bacteria and viruses. But in multicellular organisms, the range of genes, which actually 25,000 is also very high, but let's say between 15,000 and 25,000, you can cover all the forms of life. So, I mean, this is remarkable. So it's not even two or two factor, okay, 2x. So within a very narrow range of genes, you can cover such diverse forms of life. So that's quite interesting. And that's because of these three factors. So one of the factor that gives rise to one of the mechanism that gives rise to such huge diversity is because of the manner in which the genome is packaged. So the complex that I was referring to in the third point here can also be between proteins and DNA. And proteins here are actually the basic proteins, and DNA being acidic, nature is a very good chemist. So acids and bases form very nice complexes, right? So here, to make this tight complex, because you want to package, nature had to package genome into a very small volume of the nucleus, okay? So therefore, such large amount of genomic DNA has to be compacted inside the nuclei. And that is done by using this acid-base interaction. So basic proteins, which are histones, complex with DNA to form a complex called chromatin. It's a very dynamic material, and it's basically like a spool. You can imagine a thread of wool being spooled around, and that's exactly what happens to DNA when it's packaged inside. The chromatin is a very beautiful symmetric structure, as you can see here. This is a crystallographic structure. Of course, this is a sculpture made in metal, gifted to a scientist who decoded the X-ray crystallographic structure of the nucleosome. The proteins are in the center, and DNA, you can see beautifully, the helix is folded outside, forming a string-like structure outside of the proteins. And then what you actually have are these tails that project outside on all four sides. And these are the tails that are sticking out, get decorated with different types of chemical modifications, small groups like chemical groups like phosphate, methyl group, acetyl group, and so many other groups can be attached to this. And that's what gives rise to a very beautiful structure called chromatin. So I'm just going to show you the
in this animation, we'll see the
animation which shows you the entire packaging process in a very beautiful way. So this is the duplex of the DNA to which the histone molecules are now binding, and because they're basic and very high affinity, they can actually start packaging the DNA. It winds around like a spool, and then that is the basic fundamental particle called nucleosome. And then chromatin is basically a battery of nucleosomes that are compacted in a very peculiar fashion to form a solenoid. So this is actually a coil structure, as you can imagine here. So neighboring nucleosomes come together and they coil around to form a 30 nanometer fiber. So this is one of the earliest of the ropes, and then these ropes coil further and further and further to make a bigger and bigger coiled rope. And ultimately, that's what gives rise to the chromosomes, the chromatids of the chromosomes that we have seen. So this is how the coiling continues to proceed on multiple levels. And finally, so this is still animation, but this will now morph into an actual image of the cell that is dividing, and that you can see here. This is the actual image of a cell in division. So you can now see the chromosomes which have compacted will align to the metaphase, and then they will divide during anaphase, go towards the daughter poles. And you can see that the daughter nuclei will then have equal set of chromosomes. So this is how the compaction is beautifully orchestrated during cell division. And now once the cell is divided, the daughter nuclei will have decompacted chromatin, not as compacted. And that's what is important for the faithful segregation of genes. So as I was mentioning, the tails of histones that project out of this nucleosome structure are decorated, and those are the ones that actually form these marks, which are the epigenetic marks. So that's what is the center piece of today's talk. So what exactly does epigenetics mean? you can read the text here. It is all about epigenetics. And what it means is that, let's say you have information like this. Let's say this is the genome. Epigenetics is more or less highlighting the entire genomic information like this. So if you are reading for your exams, what you do is you highlight or underline sentences or words which are important to you. Okay, so in the last few minutes, you don't need to read the whole jargon. You can actually focus only on these highlighted and underlined words. That's exactly what epigenetics does. Genome. So the genetic information, which is like this, is essentially highlighted when all the chemical marks or the chemical modifications are ascribed to it, either in form of DNA methylation or protein methylation, protein acetylation, etc. And that changes the physical properties of the genome. We don't have time to go into the physical properties, but that's another very emerging field where people have actually shown how chromatin forms condensates and droplets, like small droplets on the glass pane, and eventually those basically coalesce into bigger droplets. So smaller and smaller areas become bigger and bigger in terms of condensates. And that's how some chromosome areas can compact. Those genes become silent and other genes become more and more open. They untangle themselves, and those are the accessible regions of the chromatin. So these kind of dynamic changes keep on happening across the chromosomes all the time, even now as we are speaking or listening to this talk. And that's what is the crux of gene regulation. So Conrad Waddington, a British geneticist, actually defined this word epigenetics way back in 1942. And it was defined as heritable changes in gene expression, which are not attributable to nucleotide sequence variation. So in this particular sequence, or in this particular information, you're not changing individual alphabets. You're only ascribing new meaning or adding to this information by highlighting it. So that's exactly what epigenetics and the relationship between epigenetics and genetics is. So as a result of this, Waddington actually proposed what is called as the epigenetic landscape now. And this is part of the epigenetics hypothesis originally proposed by Waddington. So imagine a ball being rolled down this kind of a landscape. So depending upon which side the ball rolls down, you must have played a game like this, right? You have to throw the ball and it has to go in certain ridges and finally go into a bucket. And if it reaches the bucket, you get a score. Otherwise, you lose it. In this case, the ball is rolling down and it's going across different paths. And depending upon which path it takes, I guess that will be clear when I play this video. So this animation shows you the state of cells. So life begins as a single cell, the stem cell, embryo-like cells, and then they divide. Initially, they're all alike. But as they become more and more in number and they start moving around during embryogenesis, they acquire multiple signals, okay? Different signaling pathways act on them, and their fate is then decided. And they go into different lineages. So different paths ultimately converge. They give rise to different lineages. And you can see here, red blood cell, white blood cell, and different other types of cell. Neuron is on the right-hand side. So identical-looking cell, you can generate different types of phenotypes, which are different cells. So obviously, that's what the crux is in terms of epigenetic changes. Genetic information here has not changed, but what has changed is the various modifications that ultimately bring about different gene expression profiles, because the gene expression profile of a neuron will be very different than that of the columnar epithelial cell that is in the center. Okay, so this could be the cells of the skin, and of course neurons are in your central nervous system in the brain, and obviously they need to make completely different sets of proteins than the proteins that are there in the skin fibroblast, for example. And because of this, now epigenetics has been shown to influence multiple cellular processes and also various different types of diseases. And as a result of that, over the last two decades, you must have seen epigenetics has turned out to be the most important revolution in modern biology. And large number of articles have been written. So this cover piece on Time, you can read the title of this, Why Your DNA Isn't Your Destiny, which we believed to be our destiny, but actually it doesn't seem to be so. Studies using identical twins, this article in National Geographic, which actually showed studies in identical twins, which showed the effect of environment. When they are brought up into different environments, they can look completely different, they can of course behave completely different and turn out to be completely different individuals despite having 100% identical genomes. So one example that I would like to give you is about the bees. Okay, honeybees is a very good example of studying epigenetics. Mind you, a large number of epigeneticists have now turned into social insects because they are a very good example to study epigenetic regulation. And the reason I chose the word social insects is because they have hierarchy, which is built in just like human society. So in a beehive, you can see that there are different types of castes of bees. So there are worker bees, there are foragers, there are nurse bees, and there is a queen, a queen, okay? Thousands of workers and a queen. A single bee decides to change the phenotype to become a queen, which is 40% larger in mass. So it's much bigger than the worker bees. And the only function that the bee has is to eat all the time and to lay eggs, okay? Doesn't do anything else. Whereas the workers cannot lay eggs, they're much smaller, and they also have to do all the work, basically fetch nectar, make honey, and put it. What is shown recently, I will not go into the data, is that these so-called castes, the bees, are actually interchangeable, and they are the epigenetic states, okay, quite interestingly. So if you take away the queen bee, and people have done these studies, then you can actually see the epigenetic transformation of one of the worker bees into a queen. From the same pool of worker bees in a hive. So obviously the hive cannot exist without a queen bee. That is the apex of the colony, so it has to be there. It's like a kingdom without a king. So the queen has to be there. So one of the workers transforms itself into a queen bee, okay? So then people studied what exactly triggers this transformation and who is this worker bee that becomes the queen. So it turned out that amongst these worker bees, the so-called worker bee that is actually predisposed to be the queen bee is the one that has had more of the royal jelly, okay? So then they looked at what are the chemical constituents of this royal jelly, and they actually figured out that there are some small molecular weight compounds that affect the epigenetic machinery, okay? So it's an amazing example of how epigenetics affects social structures in bees, I mean, rather the caste structure and the phenotypic transformation. But nothing can be much more dramatic than the case of the army ants, okay? So looks like that picture is not here, I missed it. So army ants, if you look at the difference between the queen bee and the workers, it's humongous. I mean, it's at least 10 times the size, okay? Not 40%. You cannot miss it. The queen bee is so big and the worker bee may be so tiny. So that is the difference between the two phenotypic states. But at the genetic level, they're 100% identical. So it's just about the modifications, the covalent modifications that are imposed either onto the DNA or the proteins, histones and others, that can bring about such huge changes. And now I'm going to switch gears to go into diseases and also look at how much of this information can be transmitted from one generation to the next generation. Okay. And I'll give examples mostly closer to humans so that it becomes relatable to all of us. So these are the examples of how environment influences susceptibility to various NCDs, the non-communicable disorders like cardiovascular, diabetes, etc. So question is, can the exposure to diets cause heritable changes in physiology via epigenetic changes in gene expression? Okay, so one of the earliest experiments that actually posed this question was published 10 years ago in Nature. This paper was done using rats who were fed with high-fat diet chronically over several months, which is equivalent to 15-20 years of life in humans. And such fathers, male rats, were then allowed to reproduce. And then in the next generation, they looked at the female rats, the female offsprings, about what happens to their propensity to various diseases, the health parameters. And mind you that despite eating a regular diet, not high-fat diet was given only to the father, the parents. The next generation females developed beta cell dysfunction. Beta cells are the cells in pancreas which are important for secretion of insulin. And any dysfunction of those can predispose you to disorders like diabetes. And that's exactly what they found out in the female offsprings. So experiments like this, so although in this paper, they had not tracked the epigenetic changes in these, of course, there's no question of genetic change. You are not talking about mutations. There were studies after this, which actually showed that you can actually have a transgenerational influence of diet. And indeed, the conclusion of such studies was obese fathers can actually affect generation health of the next generation. And this was one of the first cases where father to daughter transmission epigenetically across generations was actually documented. The other way, from mother to offsprings, male offsprings, etc., has been documented in a number of other studies. But this was one of the first ones where father to daughter kind of effect has been shown. Of course, there are a large number of studies now that have come in the last 10 years and more profoundly convincing data. And I'm going to again talk about some of these. Another experiment done about a decade ago again, which asked the question of, does the activity that our brain performs, okay, the so-called state of mind or how active the brain is, does it affect gene expression and eventually our health? So again, number of different studies have been done. One example is, that I'm going to give you is about how active you are, how stimulated the brain is. So the paper that is published again in Cell in 2010 was about cancer. And what they did was they took two groups of rats. Rats are typically housed in very small cages and they don't have much space. It's about 1 square foot area, surface area for them. It's not very high cage and it's not much space for 4 or 5 rats to move around. So they are thoroughly bored. They have nothing much to do except when they're given food, they eat and water, they drink. That's it. But their life is very boring and that somehow seems to affect their brain in a different way. They become sometimes very aggressive. As opposed to that, now, of course, you can't let them loose like in the wild because you can't get them back for the experiment. But if you can slightly expand the cage as shown here, 1 meter size, much bigger cage with all the kind of various toys shown here, like there is a treadmill where the rat can do exercises. There is an enriched environment. They can go through the tunnels. They can look at different textured surfaces as in the wild. Okay. They like to do these activities and that enriches their brain because they are stimulating some things, okay, inside the neural circuits. So after exposing rats to the boring cage environment versus the enriched environment, two different groups, what the experiments did was they actually, these are some of the, not from the paper, this was done in ICER and now in Nixon's lab, he has even taken this further. He has made very nice enriched environment. It's like a toy land for the rats and mice. So they really love being there. They like to explore and all that. So that enrichment actually works very positively for them as opposed to a boring environment. So you can do this for rats or mice. And then the experiment was injecting tumor promoting cells through the tail vein and then watch what happens. Okay. So this is called a xenograft experiment. You are actually grafting some other cells. It could be human cells into a mouse or a rat and see what happens. Okay. So these xenografted animals can develop tumor. Okay. And lo and behold, what these people actually found, the experimenters, they actually found that rats, which had been in this boring environment, the experiment, experimental ones, the control ones, sorry, they actually developed huge lumps of tumors within a month, as opposed to the ones that were exposed to enriched environment, they actually did not show within a month any measurable tumor development. Okay, so that was called tumor remission. So they worked out this entire, I'm not showing the data for that, they worked out the entire circuitry for this. And what they actually showed is that the sensory inputs that you get through all the sensory information that is received through various senses to the brain ultimately goes into a section of the brain called a region called hypothalamus. One particular gene there, which is very important for hypothalamic function, called BDNF. Upwards arrow means is upregulated, means the increase in activity of that gene somehow gets communicated across this axis to the rest of the body and downregulates another gene called leptin, which leads to inhibition of tumors. Okay, so this circuitry is really potent. It works. And you can see vice versa also. So this dialogue between different organs of the body based on the environment, sensory inputs, can be very important. Diet, sensory inputs, other effects like whether you are being cared for or not. So I'm coming to that example next. This is another example of early life experiences where whether one has gone through any trauma or not, whether one has been cared enough or not, whether one feels lonely or not, can affect gene expression immediately as well as can have profound effects later in life. And this becomes very important, especially now when the mental health cases are increasing, people are feeling more and more isolated. Of course, you can't do these experiments in humans, so researchers have established these paradigms in animal models. So the postnatal environment, very early in life, there could be abuse, there could be neglect, there could be certain traumas. Many of us go through this with or without our knowledge, but the effects are actually quite long lasting. So in kind of to be able to recapitulate some kind of abuse or neglect or trauma. So one model that I'm going to talk about, which we have worked upon in collaboration with scientists at TIFR, is to actually perform what is called as maternal separation. So you can see here on top right, there's a pup, okay? And this baby rat actually, initially for 14 days after birth, is blind. Totally depend on the mother for food and everything else. And there's a lot of tactile stimulation by licking and many other grooming activities that the mother provides to this pup. So now if you take these pups away for a limited period of time, let's say 3 hours per day, that sets in a program in their minds, which is called maternal separation paradigm, anxiety, okay? They are quite anxious because they are away from their mother. They don't get the tactile stimuli, of course, no food, water, anything. So then, of course, you can't do this longer because that can be painful to the animal as well as that's ethically not allowed. After doing this for a few days early in life, then you can monitor what happens to the stress and anxiety or depression levels in these animals immediately, midlife, and later in life, in their late adulthood. So during adolescence as well as adulthood. So when such experiments were done, what was found was quite profound. Okay. So this is the model. P0 is when the animals are born. Then up till P14 is when they open the eyes. So during this time, they are very much dependent. After 3 weeks, they are weaned from their mother. So this first period of 2 to 3 weeks is very, very critical for the healthy development of the child, the pups in this case, okay? So normally they are with the mother, or you separate them for 3 hours, you keep them in a completely different cage, and then bring them back and put back with the mother. So this sets in the paradigm of maternal separation stress, and that leads to anxiety in these animals. And there are measures by which you can quantify these levels of anxiety and stress, et cetera, in these animals. What was found is that there are effects that you see during their adolescence as well as adulthood, even after several months. And these effects are not just at the level of behavior. The seat of these effects actually is in the structural changes in the brain. You can actually see change in the cell populations. Different types of cells change. The gene expression patterns also change. So if you remember the earlier experiments of cancer xenograft, in the rat brain, I showed you that one gene called BDNF was upregulated. Here in these animals, in their hippocampus in the brain, we also looked at the BDNF gene expression that was altered, and we could actually show epigenetic changes, the histone modifications very specifically on the promoter of BDNF gene was changed in the maternally separated animals and not in the control animals. So can you imagine epigenetic changes happening in a particular gene, in a particular area of the brain, which is the seat of behavior in this paradigm? It's mind-boggling. And even more surprisingly, now you can actually reverse these effects. So behaviorally, for example, once you separate these animals, since they are blind, they don't understand who's their mother. So if the researcher can actually give the treatment, so you can actually take a small brush, hold the pup in your hand, and with the small hair, so let's say number zero brush, with very, very tiny hair, if you do the grooming just the way the mother would lick them, they get the same tactile sensation, and they can actually, we have seen that they reverse the behavioral changes and the epigenetic changes in the same region of the brain and the same region of the promoter of the same gene, BDNF. Not just behaviorally, in fact, in the work that is published, it was reversed pharmacologically. So you must have heard of number of different antidepressants. So Prozac, which is a common antidepressant molecule, was given, which is amitriptyline, scientific name. So these animals were given amitriptyline, and we could see that pharmacological intervention also reversed. So giving antidepressant molecules also reversed the effects of maternal separation in these animals. And not just behaviorally, but also epigenetically. So whatever the behavioral changes did, we could reverse them epigenetically also by giving this pharmacological agent in the same region of the brain, in the same gene expression, we could see changes, and the epigenetic modifications were also reversed. So the good thing is, unlike genetic changes, because mutations cannot be changed, we still do not have gene therapy. You can't do that in every cell of your body, but epigenetic changes seem to be reversible in this manner. And that's the silver lining to this entire story. And I'm just going to now brush through some of the examples, which because of the genomics revolution have become now completely in the realm of modern biology. So these are the sequencers. If you go to the bioinformatics NGS lab, you can still see this relic. It's one of the old sequences that we got more than 10 years ago. Now, of course, sequences are becoming smaller and smaller. So the next level of sequences are going to be like this, okay? As small as this. This is my hand. So you can imagine how small this sequencer is. You can plug it into your laptop and you can start sequencing genomes or transcriptomes. It's as easy as that. And the costs are also coming down. As you can see, the costs have beaten Moore's law, which is on top, the white curve. The green curve is for the sequencing costs. And now you can sequence genomes for costs less than $1,000. In fact, the recent estimates are $500. And I'm sure very soon, within the next 5 years, it is going to come down to 10 times less, $50. I mean, for a cost of a slightly expensive pathological test, you can actually do complete genome sequencing, your own genome sequencing. And those days are not far off when you take your own genome sequence in a pen drive. I must have somewhere nearby. You carry your own pen drive to the doctor with the genome sequence, your own genome sequence. The doctor will take that and prescribe specific medicines that work only for you, not for your sibling. So, I mean, this is how the personalized medicine is also evolving because of this revolution in genomics. So if you now look at the genome sequences that come out of this shotgun sequencing kind of technologies, they are very complex data files, you know, and that's why data analytics became extremely new. It's a different science now that is helping biologists. So it's not typical bioinformatician, the bioinformatician's job. You need data scientists actually to do this work because of the complexity of the data. So along with the genome sequence, you also get all these various complex parameters which talk about the quality and so many other things. And imagine millions of these reads per file, and you have, again, hundreds of such files to be analyzed together. So you need huge computing environment and also different types of coding environment to be able to solve these puzzles. So it's as difficult as this. Imagine taking a book and shredding it into pieces. Okay. So if you are now given a job that take these shreds and assemble the book back, okay, that is the complexity of genome assemblies, because you have these short reads, 50 base to 150 base typically, and using that, you have to assemble the entire genome, which is 3.3 gigabase for humans. So it's a humongous task computationally. So that is what data scientists have done. And a large number of statisticians and mathematicians and physicists have actually contributed immensely to developing these tools for analysis. And of course, now biologists are also learning these tools and are able to come up with new pipelines and new algorithms that enable this faster and in a more efficient manner. But this is a very complex task, and that's what gives us to such beautiful information. So this is a snapshot of certain features of human genome from the ENCODE consortium, the Encyclopedia of Coding Elements. Knowing genome sequence is one thing, but you need to also have the understanding of the coding elements, the various regulatory elements. And without knowing anything about genomes, if you look at this picture, okay, amongst those of you who have never looked at any genome, this picture can still tell you something. If you look at across the tracks, various colors, okay, each track is some feature on a particular gene, okay, from left side to the right side. These are the tracks. And as you go from bottom to top, you will see that different color tracks talk about different features, different epigenetic features of this genome. And you can see at several locations, many of these features coincide. You can see that the peaks coincide. They're at the same position if you go across the genome like this. These are some kind of landmarks in the genome. So without knowing anything about genomes, you can actually figure out where the landmarks are. These are kind of lampposts that throw some light on the genome, you know? And that's exactly what it tells you. Some protein may bind there where all these peaks are coinciding, or that part of the genome may be completely open for the RNA polymerase machinery to bind and transcribe the gene for its expression, or it may show a site where the looping of the genome can initiate. All of this information is in front of you. So these snapshots have now become very popular. You can actually take this kind of a picture of loci, which are multiple genes, and within one shot, you actually can know about what is the status of this particular locus. Is it active? Is it inactive? It is compactly arranged or it is stretched out? How many genes are there? Out of those genes, how many are active? How many are inactive? All of that information is given in this snapshot, okay? So this is like a kundali for the genome biologists, which gives you the picture of all those complex interactions that can exist between different genes. So in the last few minutes now, I'm going to talk about epigenomics in the human context. As you can see, humans have evolved, diet has changed, the lifestyle has changed, and then of course that leads to understanding of what are the effects on the health because of the change in lifestyle. So because of shortage of time, I'm just going to rush through this effect of diet just by telling you about how diet can affect the epigenome using one very, very critical example, two examples actually. This is about diet which is deficient in folate, the methyl group. Remember CH3, a very small chemical group. I told you that these small chemical groups can make a big difference. So periconceptionally, before and around conception of babies, if mothers have been given folate deficient diet, then that can have huge effect on the offsprings. And you can see the example here, like for example, these mice, see the change. The one that has been born after that is obese as compared to the control on the right hand side, just because the mother conceived the baby in the folate deficient environment. Okay, similar experiments have been done in sheep and many other animals. Males have been actually found to be insulin resistant after being born out of such environment. So I mean, that is predisposition to diabetes. So just changing the diet a little bit can affect your epigenome in such drastic ways, and of course your phenotype, which is your health. And such effects can be multi-generation. So one experiment, and this will be the last example I give, is where we have looked at the susceptibility to obesity and diabetes, which are basically now happening all across in India, in a country like India, which was typically malnourished. So to recapitulate that, Dr. Hardikar, who was my colleague back in NCCS, now is in Australia, he generated a model, a very, very profound model over 12 years. It's a long experiment, you know, data was published after 15 years of doing this experiment. So the model itself took 13 years to build. 12 years of undernourishment over 50 generations, okay? So multi-generational undernutrition. They were given only half the amount of food that they're supposed to give across all these generations. And of course, control rats got it throughout all these generations. And then followed by that, two generations of regular diet. So that is what is shown here, okay? So 50 generations of malnourishment. And actually, you can see here in the schematic that itself led to slightly increase in the body weight. Totally counterintuitive. I mean, they have eaten less, but still these animals have become slightly obese. They have put on weight, okay? So the abdominal obesity, the belly fat that you typically see, the pear-like phenotype in Indians, is actually because our forefathers have been malnourished. So it's very difficult to have the kind of body shape that we see in the Western diets, Western populations. And of course, this multi-generational undernutrition model, when they were given recuperation diet, regular diet for just two generations, they put on more weight actually, okay? Just by eating regular food, not high fat food, they became totally obese. And you can see the pictures here. The control animal, panel A, C on the left hand side, R2 is the recuperated animal, became obese just by eating regular food because the forefathers over multiple generations had been malnourished, okay? And the MRI of these rats gives you the actual result. The white areas, it denote fat, subcutaneous fat, and you can see the control animal, very little fat in the belly. The R2 animals on the right-hand side have fat all over the body. So this is because of the epigenetic changes that have gone through. I will not take you through the data of this paper. That's what my lab did, actually look at the epigenetic changes, and the epigenetic changes were actually seen across this lifespan change. There are multiple examples where obesity has now been shown to be carried from one generation to the next. People have shown that spermatozoa of obese people can actually carry signatures of obesity, rather gene, the kind of information outside of the genes through microRNAs, small RNAs, that get passed on to the next generation. It's quite amazing. This example that was published in PNAS 5-6 years ago, transgenerational programming via sperm microRNA can actually transmit paternal stress, okay? So our parents seem to transmit to us much more than their genes seem to have amassed. So all their lifetime experiences, their stress, their depression, their anxiety, their dietary effects get passed on to the next generation, okay? So of course, don't use this to blame your parents that you are because of what they passed on to you. The good thing is this is epigenetic and therefore it can be reversed. So that is in your hand. So the take home message therefore is that the environmental factors, including diet, have profound influence on gene expression patterns, which are governed by epigenetic modifications, which we talked about. What is most important is the period of exposure or the treatment during life and in individual. The earlier is the more profound, okay, in terms of these changes. But the most important thing where I would like to leave you is that this is reversible. So the reversibility of such changes can be exploited as a strategy for therapeutic interventions targeting the epigenetic machinery. So to summarize all of this, this is the cartoon that I would like to leave you with, illustrated by Sneha from the lab. What you see here is a pregnant woman with the fetus in the belly. And in the womb of this mother, you can see that the unborn fetus, there is another small fetus inside this. People have actually shown that epigenetic changes can go all the way up to three generations back. So the precursors of ovaries within the unborn child also can show epigenetic marks based on what the baby experiences in the womb of the mother, okay? So it really runs very deep. So this window is the most critical window. If we can make changes to the diet and other aspects of the preconceptional and periconceptional environment, and also during the lifetime in utero, that is the best time to make all these changes happen. Of course, after the baby is born, early life also, a large amount of these changes can be done. So I would like to thank my group and the collaborators who have helped me in building all these stories. And I will stop here, take questions. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, sir, for this interesting talk, like all the examples, analogies, and hypotheses. There are some questions in the chat box, and you all can unmute and ask if you have any questions.
Hello. I could not hear you.
Hello. Am I audible to
yeah,
all?
Yeah.
So there are some questions in the chat box.
Okay. Let me go to the chat box. Out of the Garvith has a question, out of the total variations between two people, what percentage are caused by epigenetic changes? So there are variations because of genetic changes. So between two unrelated individuals, there are close to a few million genetic changes. Out of the 3.3 billion base pairs that we have in our genome, up to 10 million bases could be different from two unrelated individuals. Okay, so that means probably all of us are unrelated. So that is the level of difference, but the epigenetic changes can be phenomenal. Okay, so in fact, the reason why all of us look different and all of us behave differently is because of many of these epigenetic changes. Parth has a question, as humans, can we make ourselves face highly stimulating and stressful situations so as to promote epigenetic changes in our DNA? Actually, yeah, many of the trainings that we go through like for example, stressful situations, you know that commandos go through certain type of training. So in addition to preparing physically, because you have to build stamina and strength and all those things, apart from that, mentally also, you have to prepare yourself. So there is a whole amount of, so it's not just physiological changes, there are many other things that happen through training that can actually give rise to favorable outcomes that you can exploit when you actually encounter the similar situations again. And of course, there is a positive advantage of encountering or habituating yourself to stimulating situations. So yes, it can alter the epigenetic changes, not just in DNA. Those are relatively rare because DNA methylation happens only in certain specific areas and specific times, but it is the protein related changes, the histone modifications that keep changing all the time. So those are more, I would say, common. Anish has a question. No question. That's a comment. Okay. Vinayak, were they able to reverse epigenetic changes in the obese rats? So the experiment that I talked about for the multi-generation changes. So imagine the experiments started in 2010, could be completed in 2015, okay, with all the data and everything. The model itself took 13 years to build. That time, it was only R2. They had gone through 50 generations of undernourishment, followed by two generations of regular diet. Those rats have to go through another 12 years to reverse all these epigenetic changes, because that much was the time period that it has taken. But in principle, yes. Of course, it's not just diet. There are other things also, like, for example, exercise, the state of mind, how stimulated, how stressless environment you have. All of that contributes together. It's not only diet, okay? It's not a single effect at any given time. But the bottom line is these are reversible. Harita has one question. Did they not observe beta cell dysfunction in the male offsprings? Actually, yes, in both male and female offsprings, it was observed. The reason why they focused on female offsprings is because there were very few studies. Again, this is the bias that is there in investigations. A large amount of previous data is there only with respect to male offsprings. So that's why I highlighted that paper. They actually studied female offsprings. Okay, it's important to study effects on both male and female, but many studies are there only on males, probably because it was only males who studied. They were interested in looking at males, but ideally it should have been both. So this study for the first time shows effects across the generation. The other side of the story is also that many of the effects of maternal health have been studied. Okay, so again, because people sympathize, or I don't know what, they wanted to study what are the ill effects if women go through all kinds of stressful effects of diet or any other things on the siblings. But very rarely people have studied what happens if the father goes through this. So that's one of the reasons why I highlighted this paper, because it studied what happened because of something that father has gone through and effect on the next generation in the daughters. So that's a very beautiful demonstration of this. Okay, I think Gavit has another question. We can't do experiments on humans, but can't we collect data from the cases where humans have been through abuse or neglect in their lives? Actually, yes, there are now some studies. I'll give you two examples. One experiment that happened unethically, you can Google it up, Dutch Hunger Winter. This happened during Second World War. Because of what Nazis did, they rationed food to Jews. And in Holland, that's why Dutch Hunger Winter, in winters, they were given very little food. Imagine one loaf of bread for the whole family for the whole week. That's the kind of rationing happened during that time. So in 90s, those results were published. Children born during the time of this Dutch Hunger Winter period in 1944, 1943, that period, were studied in the 80s with human consent. They were allowed. So few families actually were able to participate in this human trial. And actually, the parents, as well as the children, were studied. And they found defects because of the ill-nourishment or malnourishment of parents in the children that were born during the Dutch Hunger Winter, conceived only during that time frame of 1 year of Dutch Hunger Winter. So this is a very bad experiment, but this has happened in humans and papers are published. They have seen changes epigenetically. Some certain loci were epigenetically marked differently in the children born out of starved parents versus parents who have had regular food, non-starved parents. The other experiment that is actually ongoing, it's part of a large trial. I acknowledged one of the collaborators, Dr. Yadnik from KM Hospital in Pune. He has been running a cohort in a village near Pune called Vadu. It's about 50 kilometers from Pune towards Shikrapur, towards Nagar Road. So over last 4 decades, he has established this cohort and collected samples from humans who have been supplemented with B12. Okay, B12 is the cofactor for one of the epigenetic events, S-adenosylmethionine, which is the donor for the methyl group CH3 that I mentioned, right? Folate deficient diet removes methyl group. So in this case, they were supplemented with that in addition to regular food. So there are 3 arms to this trial, and he has collected samples from grandparents, parents, and children born recently. Okay, so across 3 generations over the last 4 decades. Okay, with and without B12 supplementation, just to see what are the epigenetic changes. We are now analyzing that data. At ISA Pune, we have done the transcriptome analysis from these samples, and the results are going to be published very soon. In fact, next week, we are going to submit that paper. It has taken us so long because it's almost a lifetime work. I mean, Dr. Yadnik will probably retire soon. He's 70 plus. He has spent half of his life just to build the cohort. Okay. So some of these effects, some of these measurements take so long, and very few people are able to do these kind of studies actually, you know, but they're important. Another question, does environment preventing cancer only work on rats, or will it also work on humans? Of course, it works on humans also. The so-called positive vibes that we talk about, or positive mindset. Even, you know, doctors say, you go to hospital, they'll tell you if you have a surgery planned or if you have any other treatment, they will say, keep a positive attitude. you know, because it works. That is stimulating your environment. You are creating a positive vibe, which somehow epigenetically alters your genes. So that is known. And there are studies which have actually shown that. So it works in humans also. Of course, you can't do experiments in humans. You can only do retrospective study. But mammals like rats are used where you can actually intervene at various stages and do causal relationships. So it works in humans. Is placebo effect also due to epigenetics? Gavit has lots of questions. Yes, it could be because of epigenetics, because it's all in the mind, right? And how does mind operate? Mind operates by making some kind of such changes in your gene networks, in the gene circuits. Akilan has a question. I had a question regarding the epigenetic effects of maternal neglect in rats. Was there a limit on the age at which those changes could not be reversed? I doubt whether there would be any limit on the age, but as I said, the earlier the better. In early age, our brain is more plastic, our body is also more plastic. Changes can happen very easily and drastically. As we age, the plasticity decreases. And that's one of the reasons actually why we age. The plasticity across all our systems, even our neurons are plastic. In adult brain also, neurons can divide, but slowly that division potential stops. Our skin fibroblasts, they age. They're no longer plastic. And that's why you get wrinkles, no longer the skin regenerates. If you get a scratch, if you get a wound, it takes time to heal. All that is sign of aging. So the plasticity decreases. So even in genetic networks, that is what happens in gene networks. So as we age, the plasticity of all of this decreases. So the epigenetic reversals also will become slower. But that doesn't mean it does not exist. It just takes longer time. So Parth has a very interesting question. This was actually asked of me in some other forum also. He asks, our state of mind affecting gene expression through histone regulation and epigenetic changes, is it scientifically plausible, or that is a bit too spiritual to consider? So, I mean, what exactly is spirituality? So a state of mind is, it's actually a systems concept, right? Mind is not an isolated entity. It's like health. Can you point out health in anybody's body? But you know that somebody is healthy, right? That's the same thing about mind. You know somebody is happy, but can you locate happiness anywhere? No. So in the same way, in this particular case, anybody's state of mind is very difficult to quantify. It is so multi-parametric. So all you have to see is the outcome in terms of state of anxiety, state of depression, state of all kinds of things, which reflects the state of mind. How does it affect gene expression, or does gene expression affect state of mind? That's another interesting question. I'm just adding to the same question. In my opinion, this goes back and forth. There's an equilibrium between the both. So one affects the other and there is a feedback on the other. Okay. So state of mind can affect genes, and gene expression can also affect state of mind. And typically, if you look at our body, almost everything has such feedbacks. It's a loop that always exists. One affects the other and the other affects the, so there's a backward loop also. So feed forward and feed backward. So all these exist. And that's why it's a very complex interaction. You can't always have it in one direction. You always have something in the opposite direction. And it's important to reach the equilibrium. Abhinav has a question. Why do drugs work at all if all of this is so, so complicated? Yes. So drugs work because they have specific targets. Okay. Many of these drugs are designed in such a way that they will affect mostly a single target, a single gene. It's either a receptor like a GPCR, I mean, more than 50% of the drugs are targeted against GPCRs. Okay, so it's either that or some other kinase or some other protein. Only now, very specific drugs have been, people are discovering and are in the clinical trials, which are the so-called epigenetic drugs, especially for cancer, especially for lifestyle disorders. Epigenetics are being tried now. And this will, what they will do is they will reverse epigenetic marks. Because there are enzymes that do forward reactions, nature's laws say that there are enzymes that do reverse also, action and reaction. So if there is an enzyme that can add methyl group, there is also a demethylase that can remove that group. So there is writer and there is eraser. Okay. So you can, since there are enzymes, you can design inhibitors, which are small molecular weight inhibitors that can easily get inside the cells, which will affect the activity of either the writer or the eraser. So if you want to increase the methylation mark or any other mark, you add a compound that will do that by inhibiting the opposite activity. So if you inhibit demethylase, obviously you increase the methylation. If you inhibit methylation, the demethylation will take over. So depending upon the endpoint, you can design inhibitors to either inhibit the forward process or the reverse process of epigenetic writing. Vinayak has a question. Are we aware of epigenetic markers of metabolic diseases like diabetes? Yes, of course not fully, because this knowledge is happening only in the last decade. Before that, people focused mostly on genetic studies. People focused on finding out the through GWAS, genome-wide association studies, mostly genetic signatures of type 1 and type 2 diabetes. Okay. But they soon realized that that is only the tip of the iceberg. Much of it is actually non-genetic. And that is when people focused on the epigenetic part of it. So the epigenetic part of it is coming out only in the last decade. So now we again know very little of the epigenetic changes, but people are spending huge amount of effort, not just research institutions, but also companies, because they are interested in type 2 diabetes, because you know that millions of people in every country are affected by that. And India especially is going to be the capital of the world very soon by 2030 in terms of the number of cases of type 2 diabetes. And unfortunately, not just in type 2 diabetes, also in cardiovascular disorders. You must have seen in COVID how many people actually passed away, not just because of COVID, but because of complications either through diabetes or mostly through cardiovascular disorders. They were cured of COVID, but within a week or two passed away because of cardiac arrest. I mean, it's mind-boggling the way our country is going into this kind of health epidemic. We have to do something at least at the level of nutrition right away in terms of affecting the health of the bulk of the population, starting from young people. The diet, the nutrition, as well as the exercise. This is the time. And my appeal to all young generation is this: you have to take your health in your hand, because you can epigenetically actually improve it. Okay? Genetically, nobody can. That is the baggage we carry till our death. We can't change our genes, but we can change our epigenome. Okay? For sure, you can do that. In your lifetime, that is possible. Mittal has a question. Can exposure to stress, anxiety, and depression early in life or nutrition deficiency affect cognitive function in humans in later period of life? Example, a malnourished child would find it difficult to get a PhD into mathematics because of effects in brain function. Short answer, yes. And that's the sad part of it. Okay. And that's why malnutrition is so deleterious to humankind. You must have seen nerve-wrenching pictures that came from countries like Ethiopia or Somalia, Uganda, and even from the refugees in Syria and Myanmar. India is no less. Malnutrition is one of the biggest travesties in modern life. I mean, this is a man-made disaster. We have to work on it, because nutritional deficiencies, malnourishment, has profound effect on early cognitive development. Start from the womb, because if the mother is malnourished, baby will have cognitive deficits. And then as soon as the baby is born, if the baby has further malnourishment, it's going to be real double whammy for the baby. And it's very difficult to recover later in life, even if you have a favorable environment. Of course, you can only do that after birth to a child, to give a favorable environment, but that can only do the undoing a little bit, not completely. So you have to start from this generation. So I always keep saying this, if you want to make Olympic champions, you focus on Olympic champions who will be champions 20 or 30 years from now, which means their grandparents or parents is what you need to focus on. Because if you make them healthy, then the children who will be born will be super healthy. And then only they can compete at the level at which is required in Olympics. Otherwise, you'll see what's happening. I mean, we can never cross 10 medals. Athletics, no medals. Because wherever all this is required, tremendous strength, tremendous stamina, we are nowhere in the picture. And that's because of this burden that we carry, the malnourishment across so many generations that have plagued us in India. So the experiment that was done in rats across 50 generations was actually done to understand this. I hope someday our policymakers will understand this.
Good evening, Professor. I had a question.
Yeah, Manas.
So thank you for the amazing talk. So my question was regarding that the early window has been demonstrated as being important for both the cognitive development and the, you know, epigenetic plasticity kind of thing. So like, are there any studies being conducted which are trying to establish a relation between this epigenetic plasticity and the neuronal plasticity? Like, is it a causation or correlation or anything like that?
Causative effects are very difficult to establish. Because as I said, everything is so well connected, especially in the brain, right? It's a connectome of neurons. There are trillions of connections out of billions of neurons. So it's very difficult to establish direct causal relationships, but a lot of correlations, yes, have been established.
Because learning and attention are neural connections are the basis of learning and memory and attention and things.
Yes.
Are there any epigenetic basis of learning and attention, etc.? So that is what.
So like behavior, there are no direct correlations that have been established. At least I'm not aware of it. But most of the behavioral studies have happened in the different part of the brain, which is hippocampus. Mm-hmm. Okay? Whereas learning and memory is in some other part of the brain.
Mm-hmm.
So, in the cortex, people are still doing those studies, but cortex is even more complicated because it's much bigger, much larger mm-hmm. number of neurons, and also other type of cells, glia and astrocytes, etc. So it's actually combination of all of these. So it's more mm-hmm. difficult to study. I know people who are studying this, but I think the causal effects will be demonstrated, if at all, only in a few years from now.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Any other questions?
Excuse me, sir?
Yes, David. You asked lots of questions.
So in the diagram of bees, we saw that the conversion of worker to queen was reversible. So how does the worker to queen conversion reverse? Because it is happening due to royal jelly. So how does it reverse?
So that's also because of the epigenetic changes. See, because if it is causing, let's say, methylation, okay, then if you remove that methylation, you can convert every caste to the other caste. And that's why you, in that diagram, must have seen that all arrows were both sided. So that.
Yes, sir, but how to remove that methylation? Because.
Yes.
How to remove that methylation? Because royal jelly was causing that methylation. So is there some other food or something?
Correct. So you are asking, in once the royal jelly is consumed and the caste is changed, the phenotype is changed from worker to queen, how does it come back? The bottom line there is, it's not only food, right? there are other parameters that can also affect epigenetic changes. And one parameter that is affected by food, it's not necessary that it will be affected only when food is changed. It can be changed even if the environment, other environmental parameters change. Okay, so that is the answer to this question.
Okay, sir, and one more thing, in the rat stimulation, we saw that the stimulation was reducing cancer, but will that also happen if the rat is placed in extreme carcinogenic condition?
If there is a predisposition to the animal, either in an extremely carcinogenic environment or having mutations, genetic predisposition, then it may not happen. Okay, so these experiments are done in extreme conditions. You have, because these are inbred animals, they are genetically identical. Only then you can change a little bit here, tweak something else and see the effect. But in real life scenario, things are not like that. Most of the rats, the wild animals, and of course humans, most of them are not inbred. So the situation gets more complicated in such populations which are not inbred, because there are so many genetic variabilities and so many epigenomic variabilities possible that you cannot correlate one person from the other person. And that's why medicine is going towards personalized, individualistic medicine. You have to understand the not just the genome, but also the epigenome of every individual. That's where we are headed, actually. And it will happen within a decade from now. We will actually be able to map the epigenome of every individual. And based on that, therapies will be prescribed.
Okay, so but how much data will it take to map a single genome and epigenome? How many bytes will it take?
Yeah, it's huge amount of information. Okay. In our lab, when we do it for experimental animals only, for one experiment, we need few terabytes of data, disk space. But, you know, everything is becoming consolidated into smaller and smaller space. I'm sure the rate at which things are moving in terms of memory consolidation, in terms of algorithms to zip it up, in terms of analytical tools to analyze the data, I'm sure in 10 years from now, it is feasible. It's going to be feasible to put all of that information in a tiny volume. I'm quite
positive. Okay, sir. And how much time does the epigenetic change actually take on an average?
Oh, it's very rapid, because these are small chemical changes, right? It's like an enzymatic reaction. It can happen in microseconds.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, so it's happening all the time in the body. We don't even realize, but it's very dynamic. It's constantly reacting to the environment internally as well as externally.
Any other questions? Okay, so I'm guessing no. So thanks a lot, sir, for this interesting talk. We really admire it. Thanks a lot, everyone, for staying with us. We hope it's enjoyable for like most of us who are interested in bio, and for all who are not, it was a really insightful talk. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, everyone.